Hello viewers, welcome to Medico Virally. First, I would like to thank all subscribers who have commented and supported the channel. I have read all the comments and they just made me think to provide you good content where no other channel is providing. For example, many of them take a topic, discuss it and try to simplify it for a better understanding. Is it enough for becoming a good doctor? I say no, because after you complete your graduation, after all your hard work, and after your graduation, if you sit in a clinic for OP, are you really able to put right diagnosis for your patient in about 5 to 7 minutes? Because a research study says, in India, a doctor takes 5 to 7 minutes for each patient on an average in clinic. A right diagnosis gives a better treatment for your patient. And when your patient tells you, doctor, after your treatment, I feel better and now I am very happy. And that's the happiness you require after all your hard work. Am I right? So, to get that kind of understanding of each clinical case, I am trying to provide you a clinical series where one or two clinical cases will be provided in the Telegram or WhatsApp groups in the early morning daily. And you go through that clinical case in your free time. By the end of the evening, the video with explanation will be uploaded. After you watch the video, there you can understand was your way of approaching to that clinical case right or wrong. Only then you can make some difference in your approach. If you make this steadily and consistently for 1 or 2 months, then your way of approaching to that cases and your way of approaching to the context or subject will be changed. This kind of understanding and this kind of study is necessary nowadays in this medical field. Because reading the context, understanding the subject and remembering it is not enough. Applying it in the real field is required. Further, Medico Virally is trying to provide you a clinical series. Is it necessary or not? I request you to comment down below if you really require it and if you feel whatever I have said is right and if clinical exposure is necessary, comment yes. And if not, comment no. Based on your comments, Medico Virally will take a decision whether to provide you a clinical series or not. When you are coming to this channel, you have to gain some knowledge where you cannot find in other channels. That is the main intention of this Medico Virally. Thank you for listening to all this explanation. And without wasting further time, let's jump into today's topic. A male patient, 45 years old, presented to your clinic with these kind of images. And he had also a past x-ray and he gave you all these complaints. And after listening, are you really able to make a diagnosis? So let's discuss about this case. Here, as you can see in this image, there is a redness, inflammation, and even here you can find this swelling also, right? Even in the x-ray there is a swelling. So why swelling occurs? You all know the process of inflammation, right? So here, in this topic exactly, this is all related to the gout. What exactly happens in the gout? Why those kind of clinical presentation was presented to you? Because the word gout itself tells you the pathogenesis. The O, the letter O tells you it is the overproduction of uric acid, the main culprit here, the uric acid. And U tells the under excretion or decreased excretion through the kidney, decreased excretion of uric acid. Okay, now, these two are the important pathogenesis related to the gout. And we have two types of gouts, the acute gout and the chronic gout. What happens in the acute gout? In the acute gout, the patient is presented to you is with a sudden onset of pain, tenderness and redness. Okay, these are all the cardinal signs of inflammation, if you can remember, right? So what happens? In this process, neutrophils will be migrated to the synovial spaces of the joints. And after these granulocytes or neutrophils migrated to this synovial space, these neutrophils, they release the glycoprotein. Okay? They release this glycoprotein. What this glycoprotein does? This glycoprotein has lysosomal enzymes which damage the synovial cell. So once the synovial cells were damaged, all the kind of symptoms which are shown in the previous images will be occurred. So this is the pathogenesis in acute gout. So here the culprit is the neutrophils or the glycoproteins. So if you can stop this migration of the neutrophils, or if you can stop the release of glycoprotein from the neutrophils, that is the treatment for acute gout. That's it, right? There is nothing more to understand in this. In the same way, the chronic gout also has another kind of mechanism. In the chronic gout, there are proteins or purines. So when there is an increased proteins or purines in the body, it might be due to any reason. For example, if you can watch in this table here, there is an increased turnover of the purines or increased purine synthesis, where for example in tumor lysis syndromes or any kind of malignancies, there is an increase of proteins. These proteins are metabolized to xanthine, and this xanthine is further metabolized to uric acid with the help of xanthine oxidase. Okay, this xanthine oxidase converts the xanthine to uric acid, and after this uric acid is formed, the uric acid must be excreted through the kidneys. But what happens in the gout is this enzyme will be overworking. Due to that, there is an increased uric acid production, and there is a burden on kidney. There is a lot of burden on the kidney because the uric acid is not a water soluble. As it is not water soluble, if more of the uric acid is stays in the kidney for longer duration of time, then obstruction of the kidney occurs. The acute injury of the kidney occurs, right? And in the birds especially, there is an enzyme named uricase. This enzyme further metabolizes uric acid to allantoin. This allantoin is water soluble. It can be easily excreted through the kidneys, right? But as we don't have this uricase enzyme in our body, the metabolism is stopped up to here itself. Okay? So if a patient comes to you with a chronic gout situation, how can you manage this? In the acute gout, you can stop the migration of the neutrophils, or you can inhibit the release of this glycoprotein. Only two steps. And you can treat it symptomatically, like for pain you use NSAIDs, etc. Okay? But in the chronic gout, here we have three kinds of treatments. That is, one, you can inhibit this xanthine oxidase. Two, you can increase the excretion through the kidney. And three, you can take this uricase enzyme from the birds, and with the help of recombinant DNA technology, we have to identify the drugs which can act as uricase enzymes so that the uric acid is converted to allantoin for further increased excretion through the kidney. So these three are the treatment modalities for chronic gout. Okay, and the gout most commonly occurs in males, and it's 9 times more than the females. Okay, and the most common age is 45 years. You need not remember all these context in the table. Just understand the pathogenesis. In acute gout, it's all about neutrophils. In chronic gout, it's all about the biochemical reactions. Okay, if you know the exact steps where you have to inhibit, and that's the treatment, that's it. But now that you have understood the pathogenesis and the treatment, you know everything. But when a patient comes to your clinic with such kind of images, then you have to present, or you have to make a diagnosis as a gout. Are you able to make a diagnosis of gout by all this information in this slide which you are listening right now? I feel no, because we have to further investigate him. We have to further investigate with this joint aspiration, with the X-ray and ultrasonography and microscopical examinations also. So coming step by step, so if the gout occurs to the greater toe, this is known as podagra. That is, the word tells you, it's a great toe, which occurs to the first great toe, MTP, metatarsophalangeal joints. And if it occurs in any other hands or fingers, then it is known as tophi. And the most characteristic sign on the X-ray is Martel sign. Here on the image, if you can observe and appreciate, there are the erosions of the bone with sclerotic margins. Okay, so this sign is known as the Martel sign, and this is very characteristic for gout. And the other one is double contour sign on ultrasonography. Here we have, in the normal femur for example, we have a single white line. Okay, but in the gout we have a double line, and that's why we tell it as a double contour sign. Yeah, we can find it exactly like this on this image, in the ultrasonographic image. Okay, so now that you have understood, there are few characteristic signs such as double contour sign, Martell sign, podagra, tophi. These are all related to the gout or pseudo gout also. Okay, so now you have two choices: is it gout or pseudo gout? How can you exactly make a diagnosis and differentiate them? And here comes the investigation of choice, that is the joint aspiration. So you have to aspirate the fluid from this swelling. Okay, from this swelling you have to aspirate the fluid, and you have to look at the texture of that fluid, that is the synovial fluid. So this synovial fluid has different kinds of texture. Especially in the gout, the synovial fluid is turbid and chalky white. Okay, and to further differentiate from gout and pseudo gout, we need a microscopical examination, right? So just in an OP, you might be thinking, why sir is explaining in an OP in 5 to 7 minutes, can we really do all this image, all these kind of investigations? No, it's not about in every case you have to work for every investigation, because most of the cases don't really need the investigation if you have a very characteristical symptoms. So only in those situations you have to immediately understand and put a right diagnosis. But in these situations like gout or pseudo gout or any few conditions, you need a proof, a diagnostic proof or investigational proof. So by that proof you can put a right diagnosis. Okay, here the important investigation of choice is the joint aspirational or the synovial fluid, and also under the microscope. So when you put this synovial fluid under the microscopy, we have two kinds of different images here. So you have to remember the letter N for the gout. So for gout, why the letter N? It is the sodium urate crystals, and they are needle shaped, just like this, as a needle, and these are negative refringent crystals. So these three are the characteristic of gout. So in any clinical cases, they might be providing you with this symptom, with these main important words, or else this microscopical image. But in the pseudo gout, if you can appreciate this image here, there are rhomboid or rectangle shaped crystals. So coming for the pseudo gout, you have to remember the letter P. P for pseudo gout, P for positive refringent crystals, and the P you just make it dots and it becomes R, and that is rhomboid or rectangle shaped. Now that you have differentiated between the gout and pseudo gout, right? So if you can find in your report, in your synovial fluid analysis report, if the lab gives you the presentation with sodium urate crystals and it is negative refringent, then immediately you go for gout, and then think if it is presenting immediately and if the pain was sudden in onset, then it is an acute gout, and if he had any previous attacks, then it is known as a chronic gout, right? So for acute gout, what exactly is the treatment? That main treatment and drug of choice stays with NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So even steroids are also given in occasionally, and first you have to put an ice pack, apply an ice pack, and then indomethacin or naproxen is given, and colchicine 0.6 mg 8th hourly is provided. We will discuss about the colchicine here. Colchicine, what exactly colchicine does? Colchicine inhibits the migration of the neutrophils here, and after this neutrophils in migration is inhibited, and there is the second step is inhibition of the glycoprotein release from the neutrophils. The first is inhibit the migration of neutrophils into the synovial space. The second one, inhibition of glycoprotein release from the neutrophils. So when you stop these two steps, then the synovial cell is not affected. Okay, so this is the mechanism of colchicine. And another thing, in acute gout, in A, never give A. That is, aspirin is contraindicated in acute gout. This was all about acute gout. And about the chronic gout, what we had, the three main culprits: increased uric acid due to xanthine oxidase, and decreased excretion as it was not water soluble, and we couldn't make it water soluble because we didn't have the uricase enzyme which was present in the birds. So we work with these three problems here. First one, to decrease the formation of uric acid, we have to inhibit the xanthine oxidase. So to inhibit the xanthine oxidase, we have a drug named allopurinol, That is the drug of choice for the chronic gout. What was the drug of choice for acute gout? NSAIDs. And the other drug here is febuxostat. Okay, stat is static, that is stops. XO, it tells us xanthine oxidase is stopped or inhibited. So the verb, drug itself tells you the mechanism, right? That was the first step. And the second, what we had, we try to increase the excretion. So when we try to increase the excretion of uric acid, then these group of drugs were known as uricosuric drugs. And there are four drugs, that is probenecide, sulfenpyrazone, benzbromarone, and lesinurad. You just remember the names, and you remember about this lesinurad especially because the word itself tells here, in is nothing but into. It inhibits, or also it inhibits the reabsorption into the kidney. So when the uric acid is excreted into the kidneys, and in the tubular reabsorption, we try to inhibit the tubular reabsorption of the uric acid with this drug lesinurad. Okay, that was the mechanism of uricosuric drugs. And especially you have to remember an important point here. Whenever you prescribe the uricosuric drugs, you ask your patient to drink lots of water. Okay, so if you drink lots of water, then this uric acid and all these drugs will get diluted and could easily be excreted from our body. Okay, and the last step was to increase the uric acid metabolism. What I said priorly is, we don't have the uricase enzyme. We take the uricase enzyme from the birds. With the help of the recombinant DNA technology, we convert it into drugs named rasburicase. Even here, the drug itself tells R for recombinant. R and B tells you it's a recombinant uricase. Okay, R and B tells you the recombinant uricase, and pegloticase, this tells you LO is nothing but long acting uricase. So they both are the uricase enzymes. One was rasburicase and other is long acting uricase, that is pegloticase. So with these two, we could convert uric acid to allantoin, which is water soluble, and we increase this uric acid metabolism and also excretion. Now that you have all the information regarding the gout, and you have also differential diagnosis with pseudo gout, how could you differentiate microscopically? And I said you about the investigation of choice was synovial fluid aspiration or examination, and this was all about the gout. Hope all the information provided is clear. If you really like the video and the explanation, kindly hit the like button and don't forget to subscribe and share to your friends. And also do comment in the video, really, if you require the clinical series, comment yes, and if you don't, comment no, because only when you could put a good diagnosis, you could become a good doctor, and that's what you require after all this hard work. Okay, thank you very much for listening. Have a good day.